Okay, so welcome to the One Episode podcast, a one-off series hosted by the students of Salford University. In this podcast, we'll be discussing artificial intelligence, how it is being used in the audio world, and what this new technology means for audio professionals. Artificial intelligence, I mean, it's crazy, isn't it? I mean, it's pretty much everywhere now, isn't it, artificial intelligence? But I personally don't really know that much about it. Maybe you can tell us a little bit more about it, Cian.
Yeah, no worries, Callum. So AI has been around as an academic discipline since 1950s. And the goal originally, as with now, was to get computers to perform tasks regarded as uniquely human. So things that require a certain level of intelligence. So initial research was around playing games like checkers and like solving relatively basic logic problems. As like the uses of AI and like the researchers who are working on it kind of saw the practical applications for AI, they realized that the current technology they had just wasn't able to do what they wanted to do. So the solution turned out to be, rather than simulating human behavior, was to mimic how humans learn. This commonly known term now called machine learning. So consider when you learn to read. You don't learn spelling and grammar initially before you pick up your first book. You read simple books, and as you continue reading books, you graduate to higher level until eventually you know how to read. A computer, well, a machine learning algorithm works by the same principles. So machine learning algorithms can tackle many more complicated problems and than earlier iterations of AI. For example, handwriting recognition, speech recognition, and we're moving in a direction where eventually we're gonna be able to mimic the human brain as a whole and potentially have a synthesized human making decisions and thinking just like we would be, but as a computer.
Sounds interesting, but a bit over my head. I mean, I'm a musician at heart, so I mean, where does this fall into music? I mean, what's happening with AI music now? I mean, Gareth, do you know anything about that?
Yeah, well, I've got some examples of So what's up? There's two kind of main areas that AI is used in. So like composition and mastering. There's other things as well, search on like Spotify. Could be used for that, for finding, you know, search.
Is that like Lander and stuff like that?
Oh yes. Yeah. So we've got Lander. So I've got two examples here, Lander and Cloudbound. So just sort of comparing the two. So yeah, Lander is a piece of mastering software, and it as well as offering like a variety of tools like samples and plugins for like actually making music and distribution and stuff. But that's not really AI stuff. The main thing it's used for is like mastering. And it's supposedly replicates the techniques that like proper mastering engineers use in a room, like whether it does or not, whatever. But the algorithms apparently do that. And it does it by analysing the musical features of the track, so like could be the timbre of a voice, it could be the instrumentation, speed, things like that, and then compares that to its catalogue of music, so all, you know, tries to find what style it fits best in, what typical, I guess, mastering moves have been done on those tracks, sets its parameters based on that, and then that's how it processes the music. So that does it for individual tracks, and then if you want to do a whole album, it looks at all your tracks in that kind of playlist and ensures that the mastering is kind of even throughout, so it's like one cohesive body of music. Even if you had like different styles of music within your album, it would treat it kind of similarly, so it's like a uniform cohesive piece of music.
So sort of same level and stuff like that.
Most of those mastering software works the same. So like Cloudbounds works the same way, where it's analysing your music and comparing it against its catalogue of music. The difference with Cloudbounds is you can add a human element to it, so the artist can edit the music afterwards, which I guess, you know, it shows how the software isn't quite where it should be, because if it's needing to be, you know, mixed afterwards, after the AI has done the mastering, then I don't know, it's not quite hitting the mark. But yeah, so Cloudbounds, you can change volume, warmth, and brightness and stuff like that, and it's cheaper. But yeah, that's the difference. But with Lander, you don't get any control. It's just, this is it. I think so some problems can be like quite harsh top end and things like that, and just kind of mismatches in EQ balance that is much more it's like a human touch that it misses and things, yeah. And stuff like overcompression, which can be subtle, but you can tell if you're a human being, but if you're an algorithm, you won't quite know where it is. And also some music, you want overcompression, and some music you don't. And it might not necessarily be on if it's jazz or like, I don't know, another genre where you typically do that.
I think it gets awkward because like, typically with a computer, it does something to a right or a wrong. Mm. And there's not like a, there's a correct, it's a one or a zero. You have to do one thing or another thing, and it's a series of just like decisions, right or wrong decisions. Yeah. But with a process like mastering or mixing or anything like that, there isn't really a right or wrong. I mean, we can all say that you make a decision one way and it sounds really good, another way it sounds really good, and you just choose something because you prefer a certain feature.
I think like that human error as well, like that just occurs with how we, how our brains work, like just adds a lot of character.
Exactly. And I think it's also, it comes down to the average person who listens to music probably wouldn't notice the difference between whether a computer or I mean, we're in a niche sort of group of people where we're actually audiophiles, we're interested, and we will notice these things, and of course we're going to have our opinions on it, but I think really the mass market who this is going out towards aren't us, and so like we've got our opinion, but
especially when people aren't listening to music on like high quality systems, it's just like a phone.
Yeah, it's listening on the phone or the headphones,
And sometimes you listen to terrible quality, like some things seem like they haven't been mixed, and people love them, they're doing really well in the charts and that kind of thing. Someone like me, it pisses me off because
I just think, what's going on?
How does that happen? Yeah.
But I hear like, so many slowed and reverb ones that just piss me right off because everyone's like, oh, this is better than the original. It's like, no, mate, you ruined the song.
Yeah, but mate, I've been on so many parties where we've just put like the aux cable on YouTube and it's like 192 kilobits per second track and everyone's dancing, man. Like,
but I guess that's the point.
Yeah, exactly.
As long as people just want to get that tune out there.
Yeah,
man,
people have had a bit of bevs and all that, like. Listening goes right out the window.
If it helps you, like musicians, get the tracks out there and stuff like that, I'm for it. I'm saying thumbs up for AI on that one. So I mean, obviously, we've got the music. It's got the lander and stuff like that in there. I mean, what's the deal with like composition? I mean, can people make tracks with AI yet, or is that like still way off or what?
Yeah, so that's something that, I mean, for me, I actually think it's more useful maybe, or something that I would actually use myself. Something that I would use myself. So some of them just generate any style, and it's not necessarily based on a, it's not necessarily trying to recreate an artist, it's trying to recreate like a genre or stuff like that. Some of them are for creating ambient music or background music for film, and I think a lot of them are aimed at film and podcasts where the people making them aren't musicians, so they need to pay someone to make the music or get find royalty free, and it saves that because they can just do it. So the example I've got, I guess if I was doing a podcast or a film, Amper seems like the sort of thing I might use, because to kind of use it, the user sets genre and tempo and parameters like that, instrumentation, kind of the length, structure, and the mood. So if you knew what style of background music or feel you wanted or what mood you wanted to, you could do that and it would just do it instead of having to pay someone to do, you know, doing a whole series or something, you know, it gets quite expensive. And like I say, it gets people making things without being scared about licensing and stuff like that. So I've got another example, which is a Jukebox.
I think I've heard of this Jukebox.
So like, whereas Amper generates notation through the AI and then plays the samples back, Jukebox actually, it takes raw audio and processes that instead. So it'll take samples of, you know, artists and stuff like that, and then it will make new music with those.
Doesn't it make it in their style or something like that?
So the one I've been loving the last couple of weeks is it's Frank Sinatra singing this Christmas song, and it doesn't sound like organic music, but it also, I've been testing it out, I've been like playing it and asking people who they think it is, and everyone knows who it is. Like, you can tell it's Frank Sinatra. You can tell it's not actually Frank Sinatra singing, but you tell who it's trying to be.
Sounds sick. Should we have a listen?
Yeah.
Oh, the touch of time, as I like the tree this year, will be a charm.
Yeah, and then in a similar way, the kind of the user provides genre, artist, and the lyrics, and then that's what the AI uses as a basis to analyze its kind of catalog of music, analyzing the kind of the key features of each artist specific. It's more artist specific than AMPA, and then that's how it generates the music. So,
does it have, like you said about lyrics, will it generate vocals as well?
I think they're trying to, yeah, it generates vocal lines. Okay. That's the big difference between that, the thing that's different between Jukebox and AMPA and some of the
that is impressive. Yeah,
that's where it processes raw audio from these people and then recreates. And there's all sorts of people on that, it's mad. Like Ella Fitzgerald, like Tupac and all that stuff is mad.
Yeah, man, I mean, so what's next then? Do you know what I mean? Because, like, we seem like we're at a pretty crazy stage, you know what I mean? Where do we go from here? What's the evolution of this? How is it going to get better? Because you know it's going to get better, right? So, like, how's it going to get better?
Touch wood.
I mean, realistically, sort of like, with the idea, like Cian said, that like the end goal is sort of like completely simulating how a human would think and be able to like perform tasks to the same level. It is sort of like obvious that there are going to be more and more applications within the music industry for AI. So like, say we have mastering right now, which it can do to an extent. I think as it keeps going and it keeps using like these deep learning algorithms and machine algorithms, like it will sort of eventually sort of like, not perfect them, but it will be able to do them to a level where they are seen as a like a very good alternative to say the like the mastering engineer that you'd normally hire. With that in mind, like say mastering, it's a lot more sort of like there is more of like a sort of right and wrong than there is with say mixing. With AI getting more and more advanced, could it potentially even like learn how to use things that are a bit more complex, like say reverbs and like distortion effects and like. So like using like EQ in like a creative manner as opposed to like sort of cleaning up like.
Yeah, automation and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So sure. could mix engineers also be at risk there?
Mm-hmm.
That sort of thing happens anyway with the music industry. There's always like sort of the fear of your job being sort of like automated by some machine or like just being made easier by like the use of like technology. Like I've heard like drummers get really annoyed about like the idea of drum machines even existing. It's like, oh, it's putting drummers out of jobs and stuff and like. I mean, I understand, like, you know, it's a sort of like a
it's
cheaper,
totally different style
cheaper
of
way
music,
of
like
obtaining percussion,
it,
but like it sounds completely different. Like, you have to put a lot of effort into like sort of make samples sound like a real drum kit.
I think that in a way, the drumming is a good way to analyze. Like, drum machines have been around quite a long time now, and they're still used today, but so are drum kits. And there was a period, look at the 80s, where drummers playing a drum kit became quite rare, a bit of a rarity. And I think people were probably, drummers in particular, were very worried they were out of a job.
Yeah.
But I think things eventually reach a kind of a, I suppose, a collaborative point where you work together and they can both develop each other and they can both exist in the same realm. And I mean, I think that's where we're going to get to with the AI and music.
So this has been the One Episode Podcast. I'm your host, Callum, and I've had my guests, Cian, Matt and Gareth, and tune in next episode, and also as well, remember to hit that bell and the subscribe button.
Thanks very much, everyone.
Cheers.
Peace.